there and welcome. This is part of the Centennial series, and today we're going to be interviewing Grace Huffman Woolf. Welcome, Grace.
Thank you.
And we're in your home today, and we're going to discuss some of the early history of the area, and as you recall, the droughts of Sierra County. You and your husband owned the pine knot, and then you owned another other types of businesses here in town. And so we're going to discuss all of that. So do you want to talk about the beginning of your life and how where you moved, like from Colorado into the Array and Garfield area, probably in the early 30s? Or
probably the early 30s. I remember, now before we actually moved down here, my sister and I lived down here with an aunt and uncle that had a dairy out there where the Cabaya Dam is now.
Oh, really?
Yes.
And then you remember the name of the dairy?
No, but their name was Faulkner, Andy, Agnes and Andy Faulkner, and that's when we spent every Sunday and during the week in church. I remember going to church all the time. And then when we moved down here, and we went to school in Salem, I remember that, and went to church at Little Brush Arbor. Then when we moved to TRC, and I was in the fourth grade, and I remember our school teacher was Mr. Reed, and Kenneth Johnson and Johnny Ashwell. No, not Johnny Ashwell, Johnny Amon was all in my class. And Marvin Gilbert, a bunch of those guys.
Uh-huh.
Florence Amon.
Uh-huh.
And then, I don't remember now. It seems to me like, that was when we became teenagers, that was when we used to go skating at the skating rink with the CC boys.
So describe where the skating rink was at that time.
It's where that little park is now, there by the fire department building, uh-huh. The old one.
Uh-huh.
That area, uh-huh, was the skating rink. And I think A.C. Woolf owned that.
And you later married, and A.C. was your father-in-law, right?
Yeah, after I married.
After you married R.C. Now, was, yeah, R.C. in your, and R.C. Woolf was the love of your life? You were married how many years?
Let me see. We got married in 1947 and he died in 99. How many years was that?
A lot. Probably
52. Yeah. He's good at, yeah, that math. Yeah.
52 years, something like that. That was a, yeah, long time, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was, with the same man.
Now you had, talk about your life with RC, because of the, you had some real interesting experiences working and being an owner of the Pine Knot Bar, which you still are the owner of the Pine Knot Bar.
Yeah.
And some of the, well, just talk about the memories of all the bars that were in TRC at that time.
Oh my God, there were so many of them. Well, I can remember before we got married, going to Arnold's, and then that other little bar there, but Day's Pharmacy, which used to be Day's Pharmacy, and then across the street, and then the Boggy Bottom down the street in the Arizona Bar, and then the Buckhorn up on the Main Street. I remember going there a lot. But the other little bar down from the Buckhorn, I don't remember going there but once or twice.
Was that the New Zealand?
I don't remember what the name of it was. It might have been.
Uh-huh. Because the New Zealand Bar was a bar that was part of those small buildings that when they enlarged the Geronimo Springs Museum, they encompassed the New Zealand. So it,
oh yeah, okay, that was it.
That was it.
That
down there.
Was it.
Yeah.
I didn't remember the name of it. But when that was when we first started dating, when RC came back from South Africa. He was in South Africa 3 years, I think. And he came back and I met him out there at old Ashballs, or at the new Ashballs.
Uh-huh.
We used to go to the old Ashballs.
And where was the old Ashballs?
It was out on, I guess on the old road. Is that 85?
Yes, ma'am.
Uh-huh. Yeah, 85. Going, well, Oh, hell, I don't remember.
That's okay. It was going toward Las Palomas, wasn't it?
Yeah.
It was out
and
there?
And it was, I remember it was kind of there by a curb. I don't know, when we first started going out there, my sister and I, or wanting to go out there, our dad had to go with us because we weren't old enough. And that was when we started going with the Hatch Boys.
So
dating the Hatch Boys.
So that
didn't work.
And so you were dating boys from Hatch? And why do you say it didn't work too good?
Well, them Tennessee boys didn't like the, well, it was back then, it was the Hot Springs. Uh-huh. You know, the Tigers and that Hatch, I don't know.
The Bears.
Bears. Uh-huh. There was always fighting around over that. You know, there was animosity over that. And then the Tennessee boys didn't like the Tennessee girls dating the Hatch Boys.
And that has, and you know, that has gone on for years, hasn't
yes.
it? I mean,
yes.
I know when I was in school in the 60s.
Yeah,
that
ever
was
since I can remember.
Yeah.
They always just couldn't get along. I don't know if they still do or not.
Yeah.
Maybe they get along yeah. now.
So the Ash Balls was outside the city limits, and then later, then did they move? Were you here when they moved? Did they move the building in, or did Ash Balls build a new building?
They built a new building.
Uh huh.
Yeah. And then they were in competition with the Silver Slipper. God, we used to go to the Silver Slipper, but Ash Balls, I think, was kind of the main thing then.
And the Ash Balls has since burned down. I
yes, and you know what? We were out there the night it burned for somebody's, one of Dale's sons. He got married and it was kind of a thing for him. Mm-hmm. And a bunch of us was out there, and I remember seeing Florence Bullock.
Uh-huh.
In fact, I think that was the last time I saw her before she passed. But we danced out there that night.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought that's so ironic, because the last night it was there, mm-hmm. we got to go dancing.
Now, was that in the late 80s it burned, or the early 90s?
It was in the 90s. Let me think. No, it was after R.C. died, and he died in 99, so it must have been like maybe 2000.
Okay, I thought it burned before that, but I could be wrong, so.
Well, one reason I think it was still in the, in like 2000 or two, because I had this ankle operated on the second time in 99,
mm-hmm.
and I was still in a boot when we went dancing.
That's how you remember that. So, and then, so there was the Ash Balls, and then you talked about the competition, because I know that Ash Balls had like a live band there. What?
Oh, yeah. Well, of course, back then you couldn't be open on Sundays, but they had a live band. 5-6 days a week,
mm-hmm.
probably 6 nights a week, yeah.
And did you ever think at that time that you would be owning a bar running competition with Ash
no.
Balls?
Not my wildest dreams.
And did you frequent Silver Slipper, which now has been closed up, but at one time it was like a recycled or a junk shop over on the other
side.
Oh
yeah, I don't know what they had there. It was kind of like a
used clothes
yeah,
and used furniture.
Just a bunch of garbage.
Yeah.
Because I thought about, Freddie and I had talked about buying that old bar
mm-hmm.
there.
Mm-hmm.
And we had gone out there to look at it, but it was just way too big. I wanted to put, I don't know why I got on this kit wanting to buy an old bar. Just the bar
uh-huh.
and the back bar. And I thought, well, if it was small enough, and Freddie and I talked about it, and I said, if it's small enough, I'd like to put it in the little pine knot.
Mm-hmm.
And so we went and looked at it and measured, but it was way too big.
Now, when you talk about the little pine knot, versus the pine knot today. Would you describe that? What do you, you know?
Well, the little pine knot was just a real small building, and then when we added on and put the bath hall and another bar, just made it a big pine knot. Mm-hmm.
And did you build the pine knot there specifically for a bar?
Yes.
And what year was that?
I'm trying to think. Let's see. Linda was born in 48, Ronnie in 49. It's about 50, 40, probably in the 50s, because Ronnie was born the day after Christmas in 49, so it was in the 50s. Mm-hmm.
And so you and RC then, you... Why did you pick that area? Was it because of the traffic going to the lake, the fishermen? Why did you think that was a good spot?
I didn't. It was RC, and yeah. I don't know why. I really don't. It was out of city limits.
Uh-huh. Was it hard to get a liquor license at that time?
Well, I don't know. We had them.
Oh, you had them.
Well, we had bought the liquor license in the first part of 48.
Uh-huh. And so you've held that liquor license since
moved it. Oh, you see, moved it. We lived down at Caballo when Linda was born.
Uh-huh.
We lived down there, and then we moved it to out there on old 85.
Was that the Caballo Bar, the Caballo Tavern?
We bought it, uh-huh. Yeah.
Okay.
Down. But then we moved it back. It's just out of Williamsburg, just a little ways, mm-hmm. there on old 85.
Was that the bar that was kind of on the curve before you dropped off in the hill to Palomas?
No.
No, it was further back by Ragsdale Coker,
yeah.
In that area?
Yes, yes. Okay. And then we weren't there very long, and then we built this, moved out here, transferred the license out here.
In the late 40s, early 50s?
Out here,
mm-hmm.
was like in the 50s,
mm-hmm. okay. Okay.
Early 50s.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, I think it's 1950,
mm-hmm.
because I know Ronnie was just a baby when we was building that.
Mm-hmm. And so I know you've got some great pictures here that we were looking at of, was the pine knot, and here's a picture, we'll share that, of your husband. Looks like they were having a good time at a birthday party.
Yeah.
was ever spelled with two T's, or was it always one T?
Always one T.
Okay, so if we see any kinds of advertisement, that could have been just a typo mistake,
yeah.
where they added two T's.
And
to
since
it.
We leased it to Freddie, now he calls it the Pine Knot Saloon, and he's had it leased now for about 38 years.
Uh-huh. And so the liquor license is still in the Woolf name. And
my name, and I pay every year to get them renewed, so.
Yeah. So, what are some of your more memorable moments? And talking about that also, what stories do you remember, like when there was a shootout out there in the early 50s? Were you gone at that time?
Yeah, we was in California at that time.
Uh-huh.
We had leased it to Ernie Bonner and Hart Derish, and went to California, and he was working there at Boron and the Borax Mine. And then, whenever they decided to kill each other.
And for those of us watching, that
we had to come back.
For those people that may not know this very interesting story, this was in July, I think about mid-July 1951, that there was as the story goes, there was a disagreement over amusement money. And what amusement money was supposed to have been was the proceeds from one-armed bandits.
Yeah, gambling.
Gambling.
And from what, I don't know if I should say names or not,
yeah.
but from what a very reliable source told us when we came back, because we had come back and click over and run that damn thing ourselves.
Yeah.
And Grace, what's your mail?
We love it, Grace. It's wonderful. You're feisty, and that's great. So do you remember? Tell us about this.
I just remember that we were told, and I remember seeing the pictures in the paper, that we were told, in fact, I've got the loaded dice that they said was loaded, that this was kind of over. But anyway, it seems like Hart Darish had won a bunch of money the night before and had not told that he had helped out back on it. And when Ernie Bonner found out about it, well, he had the taxi driver bring him out here, set the taxi driver in, and I can't remember her name, but I knew her, sent her in to get Hart Darish. He came out with two shots of liquor, and then they started shooting each other.
And which one died right there? One of them?
Ernie Bonner is the one that died instantly. Hart Darish, we were told, lived about 2 hours, and long enough for his wife to get from Silver City mm-hmm. over here. Mm-hmm. She was a school teacher, I think, mm-hmm. Silver City. Mm-hmm. But we had known Hart Darish when we first bought that place down in Caballo, first got the license, because he had the gambling, had the slot machines and stuff.
And you know,
and we had slot machines down there.
Oh, you did? So yes. You had the one-armed bandits?
Yes.
And any other type of a slot machine that was?
Dice table.
Uh-huh.
And we didn't have a roulette table. I think just the, in fact, we had a nickel machine, a quarter machine, and a little dime machine, mm-hmm. and the dice table. Mm-hmm. That was all the gambling stuff we had. Now, but then later, I think, I remember R.C. helping Hart Darish get rid of all those one-armed bandits. And from what I remember, and I don't know about part of the river, but they were dumped in the river.
Because at that time, after was the killing then, the killing really was the, it was really a tipping point, wasn't it, that there were starting to be raids then on different establishments to clean up the gambling.
Well, I think that was all earlier.
Was that earlier?
I think so. Because I remember out at Silver Slipper, they had some machines. Mm-hmm. But I can't remember. It seems to me like, yeah, this was later mm-hmm. after, you know, when they had so many machines around town, mm-hmm. was back when before I got married. Because mm-hmm. I was working at Day's Pharmacy. I went to work there when I was 13 years old. That's the first job I ever had. Mm-hmm. And I remember the gambling being, there was gamblers all over town because they used to come in there to get their milkshakes with raw eggs.
And for those that may not know where Day's Pharmacy was, Day's Pharmacy was on the corner of Foch and Broadway. And of course, at that time, it was two-way. It was not a one-way street. But it was also right across the street from Amon's, which now is Little Sprouts. So that is that corner there. And of course, the Arizona Bar, which was a very well-known gambler's establishment, was across the street. And that was
that's the reason I remember Dee and her brother, because I worked there at that drugstore, and they were still in school.
Right.
I graduated when I was a senior
and
went to work.
Uh-huh. And the Arizona Bar was owned by the Irios,
which
were who was a family that had moved into this area from, I believe, Gallup or Grants or somewhere in that area there when they moved down because of the
I'm not sure about that. I know Dee went back there when she got her got out of school and became a nurse, an RN. Mm-hmm. And I think she went back in that area and worked
for a while,
for several years.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And one of the stories that's been passed down through our family was that talking to Barney Irio, which is Barney Irio Rush's brother, was that when Jewel Mims ran, and Jewel Mims was the mayor 4 times for Hot Springs and took it right through some of this gambling era, but that when he decided to run for mayor, where the house was beyond where Pine Knot is. It's down, and at that time it's next to Dr. Hubble's house.
Yeah.
It was not in the city limits. So in order for him to run for mayor, he had to have an establishment inside the town of Hot Springs. So he lived in room number 15 at the Arizona Bar.
I didn't know that. I really didn't know about that.
So, Dario Rush told us about that. Some great stories about him living there. And then, of course, he'd go home on the weekends, but that was his primary residence.
Yeah.
So he could run.
And, you know, Stovall's used to be her rubble, too.
Uh-huh.
Stovall owned that.
You're talking about Roy Stovall, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Not that one on Riverside Drive.
Right. Yeah, we're talking about Roy Stovall. And Roy Stovall also was... He owned the Alaman, and he made his money in potash coming out of Carlsbad. And, you know, he was a millionaire when he moved here. And he was also the first, it was his idea to start the sheriff posse for Sierra County. So this was Roy Stovall. And do you remember his wife?
I remember seeing her, but I don't remember her name.
Uh-huh.
I didn't know her personally.
It's amazing when you look at the architecture of the Hubble House and how similar it looks to the architecture of the Alaman, because the Stovalls spent...
Stovall built that.
Exactly. So I think that in architecture, it's interesting to see how some people came in and really left landmarks in our area.
Yeah, they surely did. Bunch of them.
So when you were growing up, you remember working at Day's Pharmacy, and then you remember, what do you remember the most colorful character that you saw when you were working there and people were coming in? Because I think Treasures, or Day's Pharmacy, was that owned by the Knox family? I don't think so.
It was Mrs. Day that owned it.
Treasure Day? Yeah. So they had a counter, like a coffee counter inside the bar where you made the milkshakes, or?
Well, they had, soda fountain, you know.
That's it. Mm-hmm.
And Mrs. Pate, called her old lady Pate, Mrs. Pate worked back there, and she's the one that taught me how to make these different kinds of sandwiches and these milkshakes and soda, all of that stuff. Mm-hmm. That you make in one of those places. But that's where I remember all these gamblers coming in the next morning, all, you know, hungover and looked like they'd just been drug out from under a rock or something. And they ordered the milkshakes with the raw eggs. Mm-hmm. I remember fixing those, many, many of those.
Yes, that helped them with their hangover.
Yeah. Well, they'd been up all night gambling. Drinking.
Had to sober up and get ready for the next go around.
For that night. So I've got to know some of those old gamblers pretty well, too.
And what stories, what do you remember? What are your recollections of the gamblers that came here?
There was one in particular, they called him Preacher. I don't know why they called him Preacher. He was kind of a big man. He was always very, very nice when he came in. And then there was another one that hung around with him, and I don't know what his name was. But there was a bunch of those guys that was hanging around town gambling. Professional gamblers, I guess. Mm-hmm.
And so they had professional gamblers, and then often with gambling comes prostitution.
And you know, I didn't know for sure about that. I didn't even know what that was back then.
So that is something. So you don't know of any of the hotels that may have had prostitution going on? Well, that's...
No, not for sure.
Yeah, not for sure. There was lots of rumors, but nothing for sure, right?
Not that I knew for sure. I think I'd know, but I'm not going to say.
So,
I take the fifth.
All right, that's great. Well, you know, what about tin horn gamblers? You know, and do you remember along that about Kruger? She was murdered down there in Las Cruces in the 40s, and there was the Kruger murder, and then there was implications of the gambling going on in that whole southern part of the state. Do you remember any...
You know, I don't remember that about Cruces, but I remember all of the murders that took place around TRC that never was solved that I knew anything about. And I remember they had the old saying used to be, well, if you wanted to kill somebody and get away with it, just go do it. And back then it was hot springs. Go to hot springs and do it.
So what do you remember about some of those?
There was one old man and woman, and I think they were from England, and they had a restaurant there on the Lower Street. I think about where the Boggy Bottom used to be, along there somewhere. Mm-hmm. Or anyway, I worked there in that drugstore, in that restaurant for a while waiting tables. And I remember they found him out in Ash Canyon with his head blown off, and they never did, for sure, I never did hear anything about who killed him. And I remember the wife having a private detective come in and working on that, but if they ever found out who did it, it wasn't broadcast much. Of course, back then, you know, we didn't have TV and the media like we do now. Mm-hmm. So it could have, and I wouldn't have known about it.
About what year was that?
Oh, let me think.
You were about, what, 18 or?
Let's see. I got married when I was 18. It was before I got married, or about, maybe I was about 17.
Okay, so about 17 would have been about 1944 then.
Probably.
Yeah, about 1944, so the mid-40s.
I think now, I'm not sure about, that's not written in stone, but I think.
Well, you know, along that, do you remember any other mysterious murders that were never solved? I mean,
I remember one that they talked about, this lady being found and stuffed in a drainage thing or something down there on Riverside Drive.
Oh, really?
I never did know too much about that. Mm-hmm. I just remember hearing about that. And then this one, this one couple, and I can't think of their names. Maybe it's better that I can't think of their names. She owned a liquor store. And she is married to this guy. And somebody found her body out. You know where when you're coming from Albuquerque and you get off that exit there to go to the lake? Mm-hmm. Well, somebody from the lake had, was going, leaving the lake, I guess, and going back to Albuquerque or somewhere. And they saw her body laying off. And she had been strangled with a belt, I think, the best I can remember. Anyway, I knew the guy. I knew those people pretty well.
And that was Washapadock, I believe.
Yes. You said that, I didn't.
And that is documented in a book. So I know,
oh, is
and
it?
I read that. I read about that. Yeah, that they had found her, and I believe she just had her bra and her underwear on and was strangled with with the belt, and that it was in the newspapers. And I want to say this was about 1967, something like this, because I think I was in college when that happened.
I don't remember. I have no idea what year it was. I just remember that. But I remember that old Wash came up, coming up there and wanted me to donate blood to this priest because I've got kind of a rare type of blood. Mm-hmm. And they had exhausted that pipe. Mm-hmm. And so that was their last bet to go give this old priest blood so he'd get back to wherever he came from before he died. Anyway, my doctor, which was old Maloney, Dr. Maloney. Him. Mm-hmm. He told me I shouldn't do that, and RC threw a fit, but I did it anyway. I was in bed a couple of days. But I remember him from that.
Uh-huh. Washapadock.
Yeah.
Coming to ask you.
And I can remember him, you know, before that he used to come up there. But I can remember something about after that happened, he had a bodyguard. I don't know how true that is, and I don't know if they ever you know, if he did it, they thought he did. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if they ever proved it or not.
You know,
I never did know what came of that.
Yeah, I know that I got that in one of the manuscripts, the unpublished manuscripts that we have written for Sierra County, which is a book that we hope to be published. I think Jay and I are going to take this project on. We don't know yet, but one of the chapters in that book is slots. Well, I'll say it all, and then I'm going to modify it. Slots, gamblers. Slots, tin horn gamblers, and those who murder. So we have a chapter in there that is dedicated to some of the incidences that happened in Sierra County from the late 40s into the 50s. Because what is amazing was when Ralph Edwards was April 1st announcing that there was this name change from Hot Springs to Truth or Consequences, the state police came in and raided like 10 establishments for illegal gambling equipment. And all of that, I guess, was all, was a sting. And it was all the one-armed bandits and the roulette tables and all that stuff were supposed to have been taken and destroyed. So, do you have any memories of that?
Sort of. Not really anything definite, but I can kind of remember when all that was taking place. Mm-hmm.
So yeah. When you were talking about, you know, what you had, like what was available, because it was quite open, wasn't it? I mean, the one-armed bandits were out. You had them.
Oh, yeah, we had them when we first bought the license down there at Caballa Tavern. We had slot machines for one-armed bandits, whatever you want to call them. And I don't remember for sure how many years that gambling went on. Well, before I got married. Mm-hmm. Whenever I was working there at Day's Pharmacy, they had gambling. That was when, well, let me see, it wasn't when I first started working there. It was because I worked there several years. Mm-hmm. I started when I was 13, and of course when you have to go to school, I'd work on the weekends and after school. Mm-hmm. And it was several years after that that I remember the gambling so well. Mm-hmm.
What do you think, we were talking earlier about how much the town has changed. What you know, as living through all of this.
You don't want to know what I think about this.
Tell us what you think about it.
How this town has changed. I think it's ridiculous. I think where the hot springs used to be across from the old post office, I liked the way that looked way back then. I think that mess they've got there now is the most ridiculous thing I ever saw in my whole life. And I don't think I'm the only one that thinks that way. You know what? It seems to me like this town has turned into another little Taos.
A little Taos. So you remember Taos when it was the dirt streets and back in the 50s. Did you go up there in the 50s or the 60s when it was...
Well, the 50s.
Yeah. Well, and think about all the bars.
Yeah.
Think about all the bars when you were growing up. You know, how many were there? What, 15, 16?
I can't remember for sure. I never did count them, but it seemed like you'd go down the street and every other building was a bar.
And now there are no bars.
None.
I mean, when you start...
Well, there's Raymond's up there behind the... What is that? The Pickwick? And then the Pine Knot, and Andy's is closed now. So what other bars is?
Well, they have the liquor license at the bowling alley.
Oh, that's right. I forgot about
that. So they have, so probably, but you know, there's one at the bowling alley, and there is the one up by Circle K, and then the Pine Knot.
Yeah.
And Los Circos.
Huh?
Los Arcos.
Los Arcos has one. But most of them are like establishments. Like that's probably, you know, that seems to be a trend that has changed, where it used to be people would go in and go to a bar and it was more like a watering hole where, you know, people would talk and tell stories and swap stories and all of that. But now it's like it's either associated with a restaurant where there's food, or like where there's a recreation, like bowling.
Yeah.
And the only other one is the one that you just mentioned up there by Circle K.
Raymond's?
Raymond's.
Oh, that Circle K. Pickwick was in there as well. I'd forgotten about that.
Yeah.
Yeah, Raymond's. It's been there a long, long time.
Right.
I've never been in it. Of course, I have been in the Pine Knot in how many years?
And you own it. So, and what do you ever remember when Doc Noss was coming in town here, when he was supposed to have found all the gold?
I remember about all of that, people talking about it.
What do you recollect on that?
Well, let me think. Mainly about him saying that this gold was there, but nobody never did find it, and he wound up killed, so.
He was another one that was a...
Yeah.
Wasn't that a mysterious murder?
Yes, that's another one I don't think. If it was ever solved, I never did hear about it. Mm-hmm. Of course, you know, we left here in and out of Tiercy for different times. Because I can remember when we leased the Pine Knot to Freddie. We went to Albuquerque and had a station up there on Nine Mile Hill. And then we went to Sterling, Colorado and had the Conoco Travel Shop there. And then when we lost the daughter, we was living in Chapel, Nebraska then. We had a station there. And then after we lost her, we went to Casa Grande, Arizona. We were there for about 3 years, I think. And then we came back here, and then I was gone again.
But you've always orbited out of here.
Well, always had a home here to come back to. Mm-hmm. Always had a home.
Mm-hmm. Now, in looking back at your life, what would you like to see your legacy for you? Because you've got great-grandchildren coming on now, right? Tell us now, your children are?
Well, I've got three boys, Ronnie and Fred and Bruce. Bruce lives in Arizona. Ronnie has a ranch. Fred's in Albuquerque. And then, like I said, we lost the daughter. That was the only daughter we had. Then we raised her daughter, which was 10 years old at the time. Which my granddaughter, Macy, is in Albuquerque. She's a respiratory therapist there at Loveless.
Well, good.
Yeah, nice to have.
Nice to have somebody in the family, right, that can tell you what...
what I shouldn't do, huh? Because I do have a respiratory problem.
And so then you've got Fred and Bruce and Ronnie. Now, They have grandchildren. They all have
kids. Let me see. I've got, of course, Linda just had the one. Ronnie has two. Fred has two. Bruce has three. How many is that?
Now let's see. That was about
eight.
Yeah, three and four. Seven. Seven. No, the grand. Eight. You're right. Good, Jay. Eight
grandkids.
Yeah.
And then I've got. One, two, three, four, five, six great-grandkids. It calls me Gigi.
And one of those great-grandkids is Russell Woolf, right?
Yeah.
And
no, his little girl.
Oh,
Russell is my grandson.
Okay.
Yeah. He's my oldest grandson.
Uh-huh.
Macy was our oldest grandchild.
Mm-hmm.
And then Russell. And then... Tracy Lynn, and then Tara. Oh, they're so mixed up. I can't remember, but Russell was the oldest grandson.
And so then Russell's now has
a little girl.
Has a little girl, and they have. So that's wonderful. So,
he teaches in school in Albuquerque.
Mm-hmm.
And then they're going to have another one. Mm-hmm. They don't know for sure yet what it's going to be, but they want to know.
Mm-hmm.
I don't. I love surprises.
So what would be your legacy that you'd like to pass on to all your great-grandchildren? And,
oh, God.
And, because you've lived a very bright, full life, and...
I don't want any of them to ever have to run that damn Pine Knot, for sure.
And why is that?
Because it's not a very good place to be when you've got a family.
Because you were talking...
The hours you have to work and having to pull double shifts, yeah.
And you talked about that even when RC would run his shift, sometimes you were called to come in and be a taxi driver for somebody that was...
at 2 o'clock in the morning.
That was too drunk to drive home, but at least you were being...
And you know, they weren't real picky back then like they are now, you know, about the drinking and driving. Mm-hmm. Why, things has really, really changed. Mm-hmm. For that's all of that's concerned, mm-hmm. about the bar business, period. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's hard to make, I feel sorry for old Freddy sometimes. Of course, he doesn't have to pay a hell of a lot big lease on that either. Mm-hmm. But the laws that they have now and everything, it's hard. Mm-hmm. It's a hard business.
And having, were your, when you tended bar and when you hired bartenders, did they have to be trained like they have to be trained today?
No. You didn't have to have all that junk. Server's permit, I have to go get one every 5 years, and I don't even go to the Pine Knot. I have nothing to do with it, except owning it. Mm-hmm. I've never worked there. Mm-hmm. I'm never there, but I still have to have a server's permit.
To stay current, yeah. So
anyway, things has changed, a lot of the changes I don't like.
Now when you lived here on Cabaya Road, which you were talking earlier that you your first house was made out of ammunition boxes.
Yeah, it was over there, a couple blocks over, a block over from where I'm at now. Yeah.
And so...
Some old man built that. Well, some old man sold that land, and now old Lynn Mims owned most of this land down here, and how that old man got it, I guess he must have bought it from Glenn. Just one lot over there. Mm-hmm. And then he sold it to this couple, and they built this house, and then got fighting and got divorced, and he got it back. Mm-hmm. I guess he had loaned them money or something to buy this house, because we bought it from this old man. And the closest neighbors we had was Dr. Maloney lived down the road there from me. And then, let's see, the Montgomerys, their kids used to come play with mine. But we had this whole area to ourselves back then.
And you had horses and the kids rode. And
yeah.
Do you ever find any arrowheads in this area?
No.
Nothing?
No. Used to at the ranch. The part that their bombing range has now, but not in this area. No.
Now, how did you and RC then expand out to the ranches? Because I think the military, when you lost part of your ranch, I mean, how many sections did you lose?
You know, I don't know for sure about all of that. I just know his dad. He owned quite a bit out there that's on the bombing range now. And then there's a little bit left, just a small ranch on this side of the bombing range. But his dad had bought the old white place, and then he had bought several places out there, so there's quite a bit of land he had out there.
And that was A.C. Woolf?
Yeah.
And A.C. moved to this area from, was it from Texas or from Eastern?
From Roswell, I think.
Okay.
Yeah.
And he came over for his health or for?
No, just to move, just for ranching.
Just to move.
Yeah.
And when they were moving, when they left out, because he would have been Lena Walker's
dad. Yeah.
So. Did RC ever talk about when they started moving all of their herds of goats and sheep across, coming, they must have come in this area, what, in about 1912?
I can't remember what he's told me some of that stuff too, but I can't remember. I remember him saying something about Dale and Wilt and his two younger brothers. Mm-hmm. Herding goats over there across the river. Mm-hmm. But now Lena knows about all that stuff. Mm-hmm. I really don't know that much about all of that.
Well, when we interviewed Lena, I think one of the questions that we didn't ask, and I wish we had, because Jay and I talked about this later, was what was it like, and maybe RC talked about that, what was it like when they were pushing all the animals, you know, by foot, and how long did it take? I mean, what was it, when you think about moving herds of goats or sheep from Roswell to the San Andres Mountains?
Well, right? I don't know if they moved them by, I don't know. I really don't remember him talking about that. I just remember him talking about him and Lena's husband, not Horace, I don't know if they were married at the time, about him and Horace being at goat camps out there at the ranch mm-hmm. for 3 months at a time before they come to town, how they cook their food and all that stuff. Mm-hmm. But I don't remember him telling me about how they moved all that mm-hmm. stock over here. I can't remember him saying, you know, that would be a long ways to...
Oh, yeah.
They must have did something else, and back in those days, I don't know if they had trailers and pickups like they do nowadays. I don't know how they moved their stock back then.
So that would have been, what, probably about 1912, about the time we became a state then, wasn't it? They were moving into this area. Does that sound about right?
Mm-hmm. Did you ask Lena that?
Yeah, well, we were talking about that, and I think we talked about it later, that it was after, it was about 1912, so.
Oh, I don't, well, our things were 1920.
Well, that couldn't have been then. It had to have been maybe 1930s then.
It had to have been in the late 30s,
okay.
I would think.
Okay, so maybe there was just, maybe that was my mishearing what I heard, so.
Is that what she told you?
No, I think that we were talking about dates and there was a little bit of confusion about
that. Oh, okay. Because he's born 1920 and I know he was a teenager when they came over here.
Okay, and that could have very well been a typo in the Green Book on History of Sierra County. That could have been a typo. Now, so he was born in 1920 and so that was when the families moved in here into the 30s then. So. And your families moved down here from Colorado then. You had in the 30s as well, right?
I don't remember. Now, dates I can remember for sure.
Yeah.
I just remember I was about 6-7 years old when mm-hmm. we moved down.
Yeah, that would be about 1932 if you were born in 27. So
yeah.
Was it the Depression or was it just family being here? You know, to relocate in this area?
You really don't want to know why.
Yeah, I do.
It'd have to be off the record.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Why so. We relocated from Colorado down here. That's an interesting story, but
yeah,
I don't think it's something I probably should let everybody know.
Well, you're going to have everybody heightened to want to know for a second edition on this, Grace. Do you, and you know, when you moved here during the, you know, during that time, and you talked about dancing with roller skating. CCC boys, that's wonderful. Did you ever talk about the early history of the area? Did anybody, because your Faulkner family members were living here, and did they ever talk about how they celebrated the centennial?
Not that I remember.
So you're related to Sonny Hale then, aren't you? His mother was a Faulkner, right?
His mother, I was named after his mother.
Really?
Yes, my middle name.
Grace?
Noreen.
And you're named after Sonny Hale's mother.
Because my dad and his mother were first cousins. But they were close to the same age mm-hmm. because his sister, who was Noreen's mother, was a lot older than my dad. Mm-hmm. My dad's mother and dad had a bunch of them kids. And Agnes was one of the older ones, and then she married Andy Faulkner.
Right.
And they wound up with Noreen.
Yeah, right.
And I like old Sonny, I think he's a...
Well, we interviewed Sonny.
Oh, did
and
you?
And it was a fascinating interview. Yes. So Agnes was his grandmother then.
Yes. Right. Yes.
And Agnes then married,
Noreen married Hale, M. Hale, uh-huh. was Sonny's Dad, and he was a good-looking guy. I really liked him, and I was, you know, just a real kid when mm-hmm. I remember him. Mm-hmm. And why she left him and go, I'll never know. But anyway,
it didn't work out, did it?
No.
Well, and looking at the Faulkners, so you're also related to Daisy Wilson.
Well, they say I'm a cousin, but I don't know how.
She's a Faulkner.
Just by marriage.
Yeah, she's a Faulkner, so.
Yeah. So I can remember all those guys when we were little. We used to play together.
Mm-hmm. So you
Daisy
know,
and Florence and June. I like old June. Mm-hmm. But I see her when we go to this antique party thing every once in a while. Kenneth Johnson and them. I don't know who started all that, Jane Kane or Kenneth or who, but they have it once, or was having it once a month, I think just whenever they take a notion, because mm-hmm. it's not once a month, mm-hmm. and everybody gets together there at Denny's mm-hmm. at noon, and that's where I see June.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's interesting. Why is it that some families just drift on through here, and why some families stay like your family does? I mean, you're talking about four or five generations in your direct family. The Faulkners, you know, Sonny talked about his family coming in and homesteading, and then homesteading again with goats and sheep up on up there by it's somewhere up there going toward Beaverhead. I'll think of it in a minute. But, you know, what is it? Why do you think people, you were orbited out of here and always came back?
Always came back.
Why?
And you know, a lot of the people that grew up here, went to school here, graduated here, well, they left because they couldn't get jobs. Mm-hmm. They had to go other places. But then when they retire, they always come back.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know what it is that brings them back. I don't know what it was that brought me back either, for sure.
So you can't give us any deep pearls of wisdom as to why.
No, except my kids talked me into it.
Well, that's good.
They said, you've got more family over here than you do in Arizona. And then I got tired of driving back and forth all the time, you know, because I'd have to come over, renew the liquor license that belongs to that bar that belongs to Freddie.
we'll make that red the bar that belongs to Grace Woolf.
and pay insurance and stuff. Then come back in July to get my driver's license, because mm-hmm. you have to get them every year or two. Mm-hmm. And then come back in September to go to Dr. Phelps and pay some more damn bills. So it was always something.
Yeah.
And I got so tired of that, driving back and forth. And the older I got, the harder it got.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I thought, well, it's time. So I got my house sold over there and finally got moved back over here.
Well, we're glad you did.
After.
How many years were you there?
Eight
years. Well, we've got some great pictures here that we're going to share, and
you want to put them back in this one?
Yeah, they're wonderful. And Grace, we thank you so much for this interview. And now I'm going to hear the rest of the story off the record. Thank you, Grace.
And I want to see this. I want to edit this.